But he has really blessed me. Thank you.
Yeah.
and they have also transgressed. My covenant which I have commanded them, for they have even taken some of the cursed things that and have both stolen and deceived. And they have also put it amongst their own stuff. Therefore the children of Israel could not stand before the enemies, but turn their backs before their enemies, because they have become doomed and destruction. Neither will I be with you anymore unless you destroy the curse from amongst you. Get up, sanctify the people, and say, sanctify yourselves for tomorrow, because thus saith the Lord God of Israel, there is an accursed thing in your midst. O Israel, you cannot stand before your enemies until you take away the accursed thing from you. In the morning, therefore, you shall be brought according to your tribes. And it shall be that the tribe of the Lord shall tick shall come according to the families, and the family which the Lord ticks shall come by the households, and the household which the Lord ticks shall come man by man. Then shall that be that he who is ticking with the cursed thing should be burned with fire, he and all that he has, because he has transgressed the covenant of the Lord, because he has done a disgraceful thing in Israel. May the Lord have blessed us for the reading of his holy and his divine word. As I attempt to preach on the subject this morning, mess that God won't bless.
Amen.
Mess that God won't bless. Let us pray. Gracious and eternal God, our Father, God, is now and again that we come. We pray that you might bless us in a way that only you can do so. We pray, God, that you might speak to me, that you might speak through me, that your word might go forward once again with authority. But yet, God, it might be received with understanding. But it's in Jesus' name that we ask it, and in Jesus' name we claim all things done well. And all the children of God say, hallelujah.
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 And amen.
Amen.
As we this morning examine, if you will, the seventh chapter of the book of Joshua, we discover that that there is devastation in the camp. What should have been an easy victory turned into a defeat. The men of Ai killed 36 Israelite men and chased them away. They had sized up the situation, and Ai was supposed to be a weak city, if you will. Joshua had only sent a few thousand men to fight. It should have been a clear-cut victory, if you will. I mean, Israel had already defeated the great city of Jericho. So to come against an insignificant city such as Ai was without fault. But what Joshua didn't know was that there was some sin in the camp. Joshua knew that God had declared that as I was with Moses, so shall I be with you. Joshua knew that the Lord had stood with Moses. He knew how the Lord had brought Moses through a barren land, if you will. How the Lord had told Moses, I am that I am. That whatever you need me to be, that is what I'll be to you whenever you need. He had witnessed Moses stand before Pharaoh. He had witnessed how Yahweh Jireh had the provider had opened up the Red Sea. how Yahweh Jireh had sent manna from heaven, how Yahweh Jireh had made water flow from a rock in a weary land. So Joshua knew what the Lord was about to do. For the Lord had blessed him over and over again and again. Time and time again, the Lord had given Joshua victory after victory. Joshua knew him as Yahweh Nissi, the God of victory, if you will. The Lord had blessed the children of Israel beyond men. But then, hear that word, suffering or defeat. Not only was it a defeat, but it was a senseless defeat. I mean, to give you the real picture of it, it was almost equivalent to one day you beat up Muhammad Ali, and the next day you get beat up by Earth. I mean, one day you have the muscle and the manpower to take down a Muhammad Ali, and the next day Earth will beat you up. Joshua was left scratching his head, wondering what went wrong. Can you imagine having watched the walls of Jericho come tumbling down? Can you imagine witnessing God putting a dry highway in the middle of a wet sea, and then all of a sudden you're defeated by a city as mighty as Ai? Joshua couldn't understand what had happened. Why 36 men died, 36 children lost their fathers, 36 mothers lost their sons, 36 wives became widows. Why what should have never happened? Amen. Most of us have been here. Been where Joshua is sitting right now. And at a place where we thought we should be shouting and celebrating, but when something has transpired that the silence our shout. Amen. Most of us have experienced those moments when what should have been peaceful, a peaceful day of enjoyment, turned out to be chaotic and confusing. Those days when we even questioned whether or not there is a God in heaven or not. Amen. Like Joshua, we wonder what in the world could be blocking our blessing. So in his confusion, Joshua has a talk with God. And God confirms his worst fear. God tells Joshua that there's some disobedience in the camp. There's some folk in the camp that have not followed instruction. And to make matters worse, there's some stuff that folk have put their hands on that did not belong to them. Some stuff that I told them to leave alone, but they messed with it anyway. God had given the children of Israel specific instructions not to take the silver and gold or the artifacts from Jericho, but one soldier by the name of Achan thought like many of us, one sin won't hurt. Like many of us, Achan thought nobody will ever know if I'm discreet about it. Yeah, I know it's good to live by the Ten Commandments, but if I can just get back with the 11th commandment, thou shalt not get caught. Like many of us, Achan thought, I'm not going to take much. Nobody would ever know. It's just a little bit. We tend to believe that God judges sin by the man. As long as it's only once, it won't bother God. But the truth of the matter is this, sin does hurt. Amen. One joint could cause a relapse. One affair
destroy a marriage. One robbery can land you in prison for 30 years. One marriage can get you a life sentence. One sin caused Adam and Eve to be separated from God. One sin forfeited Moses from entering into the promised land. One touch caused Ezra to die from the ark. One lie caused Ananias and Sapphira to die for lying against the Holy Spirit. We need to understand and see sin as God sees sin.
Amen.
Sin in the eyes of God is a transgression against Him. Most of us think that our sin doesn't affect anyone but us. But we need to understand that all sin is self-serving. Sin is always about you. Amen.
Amen.
Sin only cares about how it makes you feel. Amen.
Amen.
Well, Achan didn't realize that his sin would affect an entire nation.
Amen.
There's too many of us that believe that what we do don't affect anybody else. But what if your offense? What if your offense causes you to serve time and then your child is psychologically responding to your actions? You ever thought about the ripple effect of your sin? You ever thought about how this one affair could disrupt your entire family? Not just your wife or your husband, but also your children? How divorce could leave your whole family in disarray.
Amen.
One sin. If you believe that your sin doesn't affect anyone else, tell that to the thousands of people who die from alcohol-related traffic crashes. I saw a girl that was driving down the road the other day. There was a girl next to me trying to text somebody while she was driving. Looked to be about 16 or 17 years old, trying to text somebody. And I'm looking at her and I said, she could kill them 4-5 folk over a text.
Amen. Amen.
Because what she was doing could affect everybody around her.
Amen.
If you don't believe that your sin and what you do can affect thousands, ask that the children who die in the wombs every day at the hands of doctors who care more about money than they care about morals. So this sermon this morning is really about what if we took time to realize how what we do would affect the lives of those that we say that we love. See, because if we really love the folk that we say that we love, we'll think about what we do before we do it and understand that what we do is not just about our own selves.
That's right.
Amen.
But it's about other folk. Your relapse affects your family. The fact that you decided you want to steal some off your job can affect your family. Because other folk have to suffer the consequences because of our behavior. Achan's hope that the darkness of his tent would hide his transgression. But the Bible said that our sins, you need to hear this. The Bible said that our sins will find us. God doesn't care about how many roads you turn down. how remote the Hideaway Hotel is? I'm in somebody's living room. How many doors you shut, curtains you pull, windows you lock? God confronted Joshua on the basis of what he knew, not what he thought.
Amen.
What is it that God knows about you that you've been hiding from everybody else? Somebody say, Let me ask you the question. What is it that God knows about you that you've been hiding from everybody else? Well, what are your secret thoughts? Your devilish deeds. Your hidden habits. Because like Achan, those things become a clog in the pipe. God couldn't get the blessing through because the stuff that was blocking his blessing.
Amen.
Like Achan, we fail to understand the repercussions of our actions. Achan grabbed up a whole lot of stuff in the camp. Grabbed up some stuff. He grabbed up some gold and silver stuff. Just grabbing up stuff. Didn't realize what kind of stuff he was bringing in his house. He grabbed up some stuff, bootleg DVDs and knockoff joint stuff.
Go ahead, Pastor.
You know what kind of stuff I'm talking about, don't you?
Yeah, come on, Pastor.
He grabbed up some stuff, some weed and some cocaine, some stuff, some pornography and some girl magazines, some stuff.
Why y'all looking at me so nervous this morning?
I ain't talking about y'all, I'm talking about Akon. He grabbed up the stuff. And brought that stuff back into his house.
Amen.
And then all of a sudden, stuff started going haywire in his house, and he didn't realize what was going on, but it was going on because of some stuff.
Too often times we don't understand how the stuff that we attach our stuff, ourselves to affect our life. Some of us bring cursed stuff into our homes. Stolen stuff. And the fellow the other day, a couple weeks ago, said, man, I got a 52-inch television. Flat screen trying to get rid of it. I said, well, how much? She said, $200. I said, well, who you stole it from? He said, don't worry about that. That's a good thing. I said, man, no, I have to wear. I'm not going to bring no stolen stuff into my house. Because now I'm attaching myself to stuff.
That's right.
See, some of y'all are missing this. See, a whole lot of us bring stuff into our house, and we don't necessarily bring it physically into our house. Sometimes we bring stuff into our house through our television sets. Yeah. No. MTV not in Hollywood. MTV is in your house.
Amen.
And now you wonder why he acting unruly. You you wonder, why are you dressing like that? Why are you talking like that? Why are you acting like that? Because you bought his role model. You brought that accursed thing into your house. Why is she dressing like that? You told her it was all right. But what you approved of. And then you turn around and you want God to bless that mess? I stop by to let you know, God's not going to bless your mess. No, God is only going to bless it is when you bring order to the situation. But Jimmy Mama, I don't care what Jimmy Mama let him do. Jimmy Mama don't pay no bills in here. But Alicia and their mama, I don't care about Alicia and their mama. Now you have to set the laws and regulations for your house. That is what God gave you domain over. If you look at the text when God told Joshua to bring up the tribe, look what Joshua did. Joshua said, no, I want you to bring up the tribe, but I want you to bring up the man of any tribe of any household. Did y'all miss that? You remember when Adam and Eve sinned, when God came back on the scene, he didn't look for Eve, but he said, what did he say? He said, Adam, where are they?
Yeah.
And the reason that they didn't look for Adam, because Adam was going to be held accountable for the family. Amen.
Amen.
When God shows up at the McMoore's house, he's not going to say no about no Janice, where out there. He's going to say, Ricky, where out there? Come here, Ricky. Because I want you to give an account for your house.
Amen.
He's not going to say, Deborah, where you at, Deborah? No, he's going to say, Giles, where out there? Because Jesus is not giving account for his house. He's not going to say, Jeanette, where are you? No, he's going to say, Mike, where are you now? Wow. Because in the head of a strong family, there should be a strong man. We keep on talking about save the nation. I keep telling you, you can't save the nation till you save the state. You can't save the state until you save the city. You can't save the city until you save the neighborhood. You can't save the neighborhood until you save the house. You can't save the house until you save the man. And I know some of you looking at me right now talking about, but what if he's a man but he feels like a woman? I ain't got to do with that. God ain't got anything to do with that either. Amen.
Amen.
Because God said, I made woman for man and man for woman. That's what God said. You the one that came up with alternative lifestyle. Amen.
Amen.
I don't know something. But Pastor, what if it's a law? Not on my watch.
That's right.
Not on my watch. Now, if you're a man, I'm not going to let you marry them that look like you, smell like you, act like you. Hello, somebody. The church
has to put his foot down on what the Word of God says. Some of us want God to bless our mess. God says, I'm not going to bless your mess. God says, what I want you to do, you got to go get Achan. You got to bring Achan before the tribes. And you got to deal with Achan. Because Achan, decision has affected by everybody. And you know what they did? People miss Achan, all Achans. That's what he did. They got all the Achans over into the front. And the Bible says they stoned him. And then they named the valley after him. They named it the Anchor Valley. So people will remember that how what we do affect the lives of other folk. As a man, I got to understand that I got to be accountable for my life. Amen.
Amen.
Accountable for that woman right there. Amen.
Amen.
What I say in my house gonna mean something.
Amen.
God has commanded that she follow me as I follow him. See, some of y'all missed that. God has commanded that she follow me as I follow him. Now if I don't follow him, she has no obligation to follow me.
Come on, Pastor.
That's right.
Come on, Pastor.
Amen.
Amen.
So she don't need me to lead her to hell. No, she can go there all by herself. Amen.
Amen.
But as long as I follow God and she watches me live my life holy before God, she's going to follow me.
Amen.
If I'm off in Las Vegas, gambling up all the money. If I'm down on the corner, gambling all the money away. If I'm out there ripping and running and snorting and doing all kinds of things, she won't have to follow me.
No.
I stand up and be accountable. When I stand up as a vessel for God, as an instrument for his praise, when I stand up and folk know that I'm a man of God, I'm a man of integrity, not only is God going to bless me, but God's going to bless my household.
Amen.
Why? Because God has honored that. Amen.
I had a woman one time tell me when I wanted to marry him, she said, well, Reverend, I don't want you to put it in that I got to submit to him. Well, I said, baby, I can't marry him. She said, why? Because I got a problem with that word submit. I said, no, you don't have a problem with the word submit. You got a problem with who you're submitting to. That's your problem. Because my wife don't have no problem submitting to me. Because submitting is not a word of weakness. Submitting is a word of strength.
Break it down. Yeah.
It's not a problem with the word. It's a problem with the person.
That's right.
So she said, baby, she said, Pastor, what do you think I'll do? I think you'll find another husband. You'll find another person to marry. If you can't submit to this one, you got to find somebody that you can submit to.
Y'all look at me kind of funny now.
Amen.
Real word, Pastor.
Yeah.
God wants us to be men of value. God wants us to be men of integrity. I don't care what you have. You can build it, but God has to put a benediction on it. destruction, but God has to sanctify. You can plant it, but God has to purify it. You can pay for it, but God has to petition it. No matter what you have, God has to bless you. And as men of God, God wants to bless us. But in order for God to bless it, we have to first turn it over to God. Amen. So my question this morning is this. I'm going to ask the men first. Is men, have you turned yourself over to God? Because that's where it starts at. It starts with you turning yourself over to God. It's not when you say, God, I can't do this by myself. Yeah.
Amen.
I used to get angry. When my wife would ask me something that I didn't know the answer to. Amen. But I wasn't mad at her. I was mad because I didn't know. I was angry because I was coming up short and I felt insignificant. And rather than looking at her and saying, baby, I just don't know. You know what I said? I don't want to talk about it. Why are you bothering me with that stuff right now? I don't want to talk with you. Can't you see I'm doing something? But the truth of the matter, I ain't know. Amen. She don't want to talk about the money. I don't want to talk about the money because I don't know where we're going to get none from. Amen. Can't you see I'm busy? Living on there. Don't start no stuff in here. Because I didn't know. She caught on. Eventually she caught on. Amen. And then we can start having some real talk. And say, baby, let's try to figure this thing out together.
Yeah.
Amen. Then we started praying about stuff. And God started to show us the right way to do the right thing.
Yeah.
Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Say right now. I need to get back to my question. Have you turned yourself over to God yet? Because if you haven't, that's the first step. That's the first step to being the spiritual leader of your house. That's the first step to being the spiritual head of your household. The first step is surrendering and turning your life over to Him. He said, God, show me how to be the kind of man you want me to be. Show me how to walk with integrity. Show me how to be that which is pleasing unto you.
Yes.
And that's what God means to us this morning. Because God, we are not blessed. Amen. So this morning, I want to do a roll call. I want to call for the men this morning. Men who's willing to surrender their total lives to God. To walk by faith. Build a relationship with God that's going to sustain you through the trial and tribulation. When you're ready, I want you to come right now. Come, just come to the altar. Whatever you need, God's got it. if you're not serious about it, I don't want you to come. Bless you.
The kind of men that builds families and
The kind of men, oh God, that understand how to be the spiritual leaders of a household. How to seek your word for direction and guidance. Speak to us, God. For God, though many of us have failed along the way, does not make us failures. But God, we desire to get it right. That we might teach our children, they might teach their children. God, teach us how to be transparent with one another. Yes. Thou God, we might speak truth into one another's lives. God, that whatever we need, that we can feel comfortable coming to you and asking for it. Bless us right now, God.
Yes.
As we walk by faith and not by sight.
Yes.
And we claim victory right now.
Yes.
That we'll be the kind of men that you would have us to be.
Yes.
In Jesus' name, for Christ's sake. And all the believers said, hallelujah.
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 And amen.
Amen.
Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor,
amen.
I am.